I'm Marcus Smith, and this is Constant Wonder. David Letterman used to feature a segment on his show called Stupid Human Tricks. Nowadays, because we humans apparently have graduated to amusements a little bit less Neanderthal, we just go straight to YouTube and we watch the incredible and amazing tricks, none of them stupid, performed by animals. Maybe this is why Letterman is history now. Well, anyway, I have often found myself on YouTube watching something like an osprey cam just to see that moment when the parent bird leaves or returns to the nest. That is stunning to watch. And I have watched an octopus squeeze its way through holes that are too small for an octopus to squeeze through. I have yet to see, though, a sperm whale fold its rib cage down into a new shape to allow it to dive fathoms and fathoms down into the sea. Did you know that they can do that? The rib cage, it folds down. No YouTuber that I know of can capture this trick easily. Frankly, I don't even know how biologists have been able to ascertain that a sperm whale is capable of such a trick, such a feat. The rib cage folds down, the lungs deflate, the whole ordeal does not kill them. It actually helps them get along. Well, we're going to follow the sperm whale story down into the depths of the sea. And when I say the depths, I'm talking about the watery abyss where daylight does not penetrate. There are more stories to be told about this place than we have time for, but we're going to give it a go with Dr. Helen Scales, marine biologist, writer, broadcaster. Helen Scales teaches at Cambridge University and is science advisor for the marine conservation charity Sea Changers. She's author of a new book. I understand that as we're having our conversation today, the ink is scarcely dry on the pages of this new tome. It's titled The Brilliant Abyss, Exploring the Majestic Hidden Life of the Deep Ocean and the looming threat that imperils it. Helen Scales, welcome back to Constant Wonder.
What a wonderful introduction. Thank you so much for having me back. It's a huge pleasure.
What you don't know about me is that from the time I was a little tiny kid, whales were fascinating to me. I grew up in Southern California. We had gray whales off the coast. Never seen a sperm whale, though. Have you?
I have. It was one of those animals that it was on that, you have that wish list, don't you, of things like one day I'll be in the right place and I'll see one of these things. And I happened to be out in the Gulf of Mexico on a deep sea research expedition, and what should show its face? Well, several of them at the surface, but a pod of sperm whales. And you realize that you can tell it's them pretty quickly. They're very strange looking things compared to other whales. There's that blocky nose of theirs, this square head, is so distinct that as soon as one of them shows up, near the surface, you can pretty much immediately tell it's one of them. And they have this weird lopsided spout. Most whales, if they spout, they go straight up. And there's different shapes and things, but the sperm whale goes off to one side because they only have one nostril, which is connected to the outside. There you go.
They only have one nostril. That's very
connected to the outside. Yeah, the other one is kind of internal, and that's a key part of what they get up to down in the deep ocean. But only one they breathe through, so only one sort of nostril shoots off to one side when they come up to breathe. And so if you see this sort of weird puff going off sideways with a whale, you've got a sperm whale. That's what it is.
Yep. Did I get the business right about that rib cage on these animals?
You did. Yeah, you did. And it's a really good question how we know that, because I'm fairly sure there isn't I don't know. What would we need? Some sort of a scanning device, to see inside of these animals as they're diving down? I imagine it's anatomists who figured this all out, who've looked very carefully at the bodies of these animals, which we do know pretty well because, a lot of people have had their hands on a lot of dead sperm whales, unfortunately, through the whaling industry that's been raging for, has raged for hundreds of years. They've got their hands on a lot of specimens. So I imagine in that time, that's one thing they worked out, was that they have these presumably hinged ribs that would fold down. And therefore, that's, I guess, a pretty strong theory for what happens as they go down. Because we know as the pressure increases, human lungs would shrink to almost nothing too, but we'd be not doing so well if we went down as deep as sperm whales go, I think.
Well, I think we do want to eventually get to the story of how they survive at that depth for so long, because they don't just inflate their lungs and hold it. We'll get to that. But first, there's a little bit of history here, I understand. I intentionally started with the sperm whale because going down into the abyss is something that began, I understand, with some of those early whalers following sperm whales.
Yeah, that's right. So it's really, I guess, the whalers were understanding something about our planet, which other people, and including a lot of scientists at that time, so we're talking kind of 18th, 19th century whaling, they figured out, before really anyone else had cottoned on, just how deep animals go in the ocean. It was around the same time that there was a pretty solid idea that, you know, the deeper down you go, life basically runs out. And, you know, anything below a few hundred feet, perhaps 1,000 feet or so, there's nothing down below that. And why would something like a whale bother going down that deep? If there's nothing there for it to eat, there's no other way. Why would it do that? And yet what the whalers saw, and they knew only too well, especially back in those days, they were using huge long lengths of rope to attach to these poor animals as they were harpooned. And I believe that these lengths came in standard sizes of about 225 fathoms, which is roughly 1,300 feet. And they would need, when they caught a sperm whale on the end of one of these harpoons, they would need to tie together three or four of these lengths of rope because they would dive down so deep. So it gives you this idea that these animals are going a long, long way down in the ocean. And then what's more, when they come up and when these animals were, you know, sperm whales were finally caught and, you know, they succumbed to this human hunting, came to the surface and were being butchered. You know, they were found to have stomachs full of these enormous squid beaks. Now, the hard parts of a squid, this kind of parrot-like beak, which is how these animals feed. And sperm whales have stomachs full of these things, indicating that that is what they eat. And presumably, we can therefore figure out that the reason they're diving down so deep, dragging all this rope after them, is to catch those squid. So those squid must be hiding down in the deep ocean too. So I guess that's the thing with those whalers. I mean, yeah, they were hunting these animals on a huge scale, but at the same time, learning about this aspect of our planet, that there's a lot more going on in the deep ocean than perhaps other people imagined that was going on at the time.
Well, I want you to give us some kind of a sense for just how deep the ocean can be and is at its deepest. I mean, the math that you just gave us, something approximately 1,300 feet times maybe three or four such lengths, we're not even exceeding 10,000 feet yet, and the ocean can be a whole lot deeper than that.
It can indeed. So the average depth really is around about 2.5 miles. And I'm not very good at working out how many feet that is. That's a lot of feet, though, isn't it? It's a lot of feet. And then it goes even deeper than that. That's just the average. But if we take the deepest parts of the ocean into account, so we have these incredible deep trenches which form. There's dozens of these things all around the ocean, particularly in the Pacific. They form when two tectonic oceanic plates slam together and one pushes down. And you find these incredibly deep parts of the ocean. And the deepest one you may know is the Mariana Trench, that famously greatest depth of the ocean. And that gets down to just shy of about 7 miles. So the very greatest depth is there, around 7 miles down, which is really unthinkably big. If you imagine walking that distance, and that's how far it would take you to get to the bottom of the ocean, it's truly, I think, truly mind-bending.
You know, we Americans are often in the habit of stacking Empire State Buildings on top of each other. But we could just talk about the verticality, the depth. But there's another aspect here that you talk about that has to do with how much of the Earth's biosphere is watery. I mean, this is just phenomenal.
It really is. I mean, if we think about, yeah, you're right, this huge depth, I think it's something like 10 times up and down the Empire State Building or some such figure as that is the depth of the ocean. But we've also got the fact that it's the deep ocean, anything below around about 600 feet is what we consider to be deep. That covers more than half of the surface of the planet. So, you know, multiply that all up and you get this enormous volume. It's a billion cubic kilometers, and my brain isn't going to be able to tell you how many cubic miles, but let's just say really enormous. And I worked out that if the Amazon river was going to fill up that volume of deep ocean from the 600 feet mark down, the Amazon River, the biggest river we have, would take 150,000 years to fill up the deep ocean. It's not how it happened. You know, that's not where the ocean came from. But just to kind of try and imagine that space. And we know that that forms something like 90 or 95% of the biosphere, the living space or the space available to living creatures on this planet. So, you know, so life on Earth is life in the deep, pretty much. We have, if we want to know about what goes on planet Earth, we absolutely have to look into this extraordinary realm of our planet, which is the deep ocean.
Can you carve it up into layers for me? Because I know we can start with where the sunlight is, but there are different terms that people have used to kind of describe the different regions as you go further and further down.
Yeah, and there's good reason for that too. It's not just simply so we can find our way around. It's actually as the light drops and as the pressure increases down as you're going further down in the ocean, the conditions change and we see very different types of animals living there. So we have the first sort of official zone of the deep is the twilight zone. And that begins at this kind of 660 feet mark, goes down to about 3,300 feet. And that's where there is still a little bit of sunlight left. It's a very dim blue light that's trickling down from above. All the other colors have been absorbed further up. So it's like, imagine, yeah, walking out on a clear night just after the sun has set and you look up at the sky and it's got that beautiful kind of deep blue, inky blue color. And it's like that in the twilight zone all through the day. So a bit of light, but not very much. So a shadowy world in that twilight zone. Below that, though, basically at around that 3,300 feet mark, the sun is gone completely. So we enter the midnight zone where there's never any illumination from the sun, doesn't make it into that depth. And you can keep on going down. And then this we get into what we call the abyss. Sort of officially, the abyss is around about 12,000 feet. But that's you know, the word abyss we use quite generally as well, just to mean kind of the deep ocean. But officially, it's around about that sort of depth. And then, you know, that goes down and down. And then we get into those very greatest depths in those trenches, starting at around about, I think, 18,000 feet. And that's the Hadal zone, which I love. The idea that it's named after the Greek underworld.
That's where it comes from.
You know, and things down there are getting pretty extreme in terms of the pressure and everything else. So it's definitely the most extreme part of the deep is the Hadal zone.
Well, let's talk about some categories aside from whales. Oh, no, let's stick with the sperm whale because we need you to explain how the oxygen works in the blood because they're not holding their breath. They're not swallowing a lot of air and keeping it in their lungs. They can't do that. It would destroy the lungs.
The pressure is just too high. I mean, it wouldn't be possible to keep anything inflated. The depths that they hunt at, we should say that, you know, sperm whales are spending 3/4 of their lives down in the deep ocean, at least 3,000 feet, even down to about 6,000 feet. They're not the absolute deepest diving whales. There are others. It's a Cuvier's beaked whale, which I believe has got the record for the deepest dive. But, you know, sperm whales regularly, you know, like routinely, they're spending their lives hunting after giant squid down in the deep regions of the ocean. And they do this, yeah, the oxygen they bring with them isn't in their lungs. It's not as a gas, but it's locked away in their blood and in their muscles. Something like a fifth of the weight of an enormous sperm whale is made up of this huge volume of blood. And they also have this particular molecule in their muscles called myoglobin. We have it too, but we don't have nearly as much as deep diving mammals do, including sperm whales. They have about 10 times as much of this molecule. It's a bit like the hemoglobin we have in our blood, which again holds oxygen. But they have enormous amounts of this stuff, so much myoglobin, which locks onto oxygen, that it should, in theory, make sperm whales' kind of muscles totally just clog up and get stiff and they shouldn't be able to move. But it's been discovered that that form of that molecule is actually slightly positively charged. So actually it's kind of like a non-stick version of this really important molecule so they can stay supple, they can keep swimming and take down with them enormous reserves of oxygen, which last them for like an hour at least, maybe hour and a half, diving down into the deep ocean. And they draw on that supply and, you know, eventually it starts to run down and they come back to the surface and it'll take them a sperm whale needs only about 7 or 8 minutes at the surface to off-gas the carbon dioxide they've built up to recharge those oxygen stores. And then they go back down again and carry on hunting. It's incredible. It really is. They're just so well adapted to this life of hunting down in the deep and exploiting these amazing populations of squid that are hunting down there themselves so that they can, you know, they can survive and thrive. It's all rather wonderful.
Well, now that you have solved the problem of the oxygen supply for the sperm whale, we've got to get to the hunting part. And I know they have eyes, but if it's going to be midnight down there or darker, what's darker than midnight in the abyss, the eyes don't seem to have much of a function down there for hunting.
No, that's it. This is the other big secret that scientists only fairly recently confirmed as to how sperm whales go about hunting. You know, there's lots of theories. Was it that did they swim down and just kind of hang there quietly and wait for stuff to come by? But it turns out they are basically the giant underwater equivalents of bats. They use echolocation. They are incredibly noisy creatures. They have these big, enormous noses. That blocky front snout on a sperm whale is basically their nose, the biggest nose, I think, in the animal kingdom, that makes one of the loudest sounds that we know of. And they basically emit these incredibly loud clicks. Not a beautiful song like a humpback whale, but a very important click, which they interrogate the darkness with. And they're listening for echoes coming back from their prey. And particularly these squid, they've got those hard beaks that will be kind of, that will form a good echo. They have these, a lot of squid will have tough sort of hooks on their suckers, which again will reflect that sound. So the sperm whales are kind of pouring this kind of cascade of sound into the water below them and around them. And they listen back to the reflections from their prey. And then they chase after them. We've had studies involving kind of sort of hydrophones and movement sensors, which track these chase scenes through the deep. I mean, can you imagine? We now know that sperm whales very much do chase after these squid, and they have a bit of a run. They try and get away, and the squid follow after them, getting louder and closer. And then a very dramatic thing happens at the last minute. As they're really zeroing in on that squid, the sperm whale stops clicking. They fall silent because it's possible the squid probably can't hear them, but they might maybe get some sense of ripples of that sound through the water. So the sperm whale falls silent and just sort of zooms in the last few feet to the squid. And then they'll perform a handbrake turn. Can you believe it? They will basically spin on a dime, suck in that squid and get their food, which to me, it's just the most wonderful chase scene I can imagine happening down there in the dark depths, all through the power of sound. How amazing is that?
Yeah. Well, we've got now a lot of talk going on here about a rather blubbery creature with a folding rib cage. It's, for the most part, a kind of a rigid beast. And then we've got that squishy squid. I want to get into the squishy animals now, the ones that are less rigid than a whale, because down deep, there, to me, it just seems like a contradiction in terms with all the pressure that you should have living things that are made out of wispy, just, very fragile materials, kind of gooey stuff.
Yeah, there's a lot of very gooey creatures. Yeah, it's not, I would say it's one of the most common body forms, whether there are fish that have lots of gooiness about them, but also just a whole range of incredible life forms, unlike anything we see anywhere else, that are real deep sea specialists. A lot of them look like what we might imagine jellyfish are. Some of them are true jellyfish, others are sort of slightly different, strange animals scattered across the family tree of creatures. But yeah, jelly, basically gelatin, a kind of a thin, watery bag of not very muscular, basically, yeah, just a watery body, is in fact a very useful way of being in the deep ocean for the reason that, well, firstly, yeah, there is all that pressure. And actually, that's not so much of a problem if you're made of jelly. You've got, it's coming in on equally on all sides. You haven't got any gas bubbles inside, which would collapse, like the sperm whale's lungs. So actually jelly is okay in that respect. But the real thing it has going for it is that it's a very cheap material to build a body from. It's not a muscle that requires a whole bunch of energy to power it. And it doesn't need an awful lot of upkeep in terms of energy kind of going in. So, and that's really important because there's not a lot of food down in the deep ocean. It's dark down there. There's no sunlight to power plant life, which is what, life out here on land is basically dependent on, is that energy coming in from the sun being converted into sugars by plants and so on. None of that happens in the deep ocean. All they have is this thin trickle of what we call marine snow coming down from the surface. It sounds really lovely. It's these white fluffy particles which come down from the surface. Basically, it's dead plankton, as well as their droppings, all stuck together by this gooey stuff that microbes make. But it's a really important source of carbon and food. And a lot of those animals down in the deep north, these jellies will actually catch that snow as it's falling. But there's just not very much of it. Around 2% of the food that's made at the surface in the surface seas falls down into the deep ocean. So it's a hungry place. And therefore, if you can evolve a way to be really efficient about building a body and using that body, then, you know, you're going to be able to survive down there. And you're not rushing around like a sperm whale that needs all that oxygen and all that squid to eat. You can basically float there, being this incredibly delicate jelly creature, and pick up your food from the water as it's falling past. It works if you're down there. Not so much if you come back up to the surface. You take one of these animals, there's a thing called a dinner plate jelly that's an amazing predator of the deep, actually. We know they hunt all sorts of other animals. But you bring one up to the surface and it basically falls through your fingers. It's that delicate. But it works in the deep. It's a deep adapted creature. And, you know, we see worms with great big jelly sort of bubbles on their body. There's one incredible thing which has been nicknamed the pig's rump worm. And you see one and you know why, because it does just look like a pair of little buttocks floating around in the water. And that, again, it gives it buoyancy too. That's another added benefit of jelly. It kind of floats there. And for a worm that lives in the deep ocean, same as these jellyfish, why not? That's what you need to do. Just kind of hang there, wait for the food to come along, and you'll be all right.
You know, you have put your finger on something that I think informs a lot of the science of the deep, deep ocean, which is just the incredibly daunting challenge of any kind of inquiry where if you bring something to the surface, you either destroy it or you change its relationship to the world around it. You're not going to be able to see things behaving in their natural habitat because you can't get down there. It seems to me that this science is up against a huge obstacle of just observation.
Yeah, and I would say, I mean, the wonderful thing about deep sea science and the place we're at the moment, and I would say we're in this real, I'd say golden age of research, is because we have amazing new technologies which allow that observation in real time, in the deep, with these animals, in their environment, behaving reasonably normally. I mean, we're talking about deep sea submersibles. Most of them remotely operated. There are some that humans go down in, and we do have some in-person exploration in the deep. But by and large, like the majority of research in this way is being carried out by remote technologies. So we have these deep diving robots. You can send them down now into the deep with amazing cameras that feed high definition live footage up to the surface. You're watching in real time. They have, you know, amazing lights, amazing sensors, things that let us see into the deep like we've never really had before. And sure, a big submersible with bright lights is going to probably scare a few of those deep sea creatures, but actually a lot of them don't seem to mind too much. And they will go about their time and go about their lives and we can watch on. So that is how we are getting an extraordinary view of life in the deep, how life behaves, what's eating what, how are those ecosystems working. And the more we have those eyes in the deep, we have some amazing sort of autonomous vehicles too, robots that go off and swim by themselves, taking pictures and come back and show us what they've seen. You know, there are so many ways in which we're looking in the deep, in new ways in which we're seeing what's down there. And every time someone does, they'll see something new because of the huge size of the deep and the fact that, there's still so much we haven't looked at. You know, most of the time people are going to completely new places that haven't been examined in detail before. And because the deep is so varied, there's so much different stuff down there in different places, different geology, different topography, different organisms. It's all just, it's all waiting to be discovered, basically, which I find just so exciting.
Having mentioned the fact that sunlight does not make its way that far down, that is invitation enough for us to talk about bioluminescence, the creatures that generate their own light. We're going to do that after a short break here on our show. We're visiting with Dr. Helen Scales, and she is author of The Brilliant Abyss, Exploring the Majestic Hidden Life of the Deep Ocean and the Looming Threat that Imperils It. We will get to those perils as well. Stay tuned to Constant Wonder. I'm Marcus Smith, and this is Constant Wonder. Thanks for joining with us to talk about the deep, deep, deep parts of the ocean. We're visiting with Dr. Helen Scales, author of The Brilliant Abyss, Exploring the Majestic Hidden Life of the Deep Ocean and the Looming Threat That Imperils It. Helen, what about the fact that the creatures are generating their own light and we may not even have our heads wrapped around why they do that exactly? It's not that they need headlights necessarily.
Oh, it's a wonderful thing. I mean, we've, again, using these amazing deep submersibles to film the deep and to understand more about what's down there. Huge archives of footage from the deep have shown that around about 75% of animals living down through the water column in the deep ocean are bioluminescent. They can make their own light. So it's almost compulsory. You know, life in the deep equals light making, basically. And I guess we can understand that from the point of view of knowing just how dark it is. Even in the twilight zone, you've got this dusky dark light, and then none at all in the midnight zone. It makes sense that being able to make light for animals to produce their own light, there's clearly a great selective pressure for that. So, you know, life needs, you know, is finding really useful and important things to do with that light. So, I mean, one of the leading experts, Steve Haddock, who is a bioluminescent expert, he refers to these ideas as to why so much light is made. He refers to them as just so stories, because we have, you know, we have really good theories for how animals in the deep might use light for hunting, you know, maybe to see in the dark. Actually, there are some flashlight fish which seem to have lights facing forwards from their under their eyes, which could well be illuminating what they're looking at. A lot of the theories involve escaping from predators, you know, throw a mouthful of glowing goo in the face of something that's trying to eat you, and it's most likely going to be fairly shocked and confused, and it'll give you a second to scarper and scram out of the way. But the reason he calls them just so stories is that we have very few, at least on record, examples, or on camera, if you like, examples of this actually happening, of an animal behaving naturally in its environment, switching on its lights at will to do what it is that it does with them. We know mostly about these bioluminescent animals because these are ones that have been brought up very carefully to the surface. You can keep them for a while in laboratories, and various things you can do to them. You can prod them with chemicals. You can just physically prod them. You can even flash a light at some of them and they will flash back at you. So we know these things make light in those ways, but it's seeing them behaving naturally is really difficult, especially these lights are not very bright. So when you're down in a submersible with the big headlights on, that bioluminescence is often not obvious. So it requires really great technologies, which are just coming through, actually. And people at Monterey Bay Research Institute in California are working on that, on very high sensitivity cameras to be able to pick up, perhaps, you know, switch the lights off of a submersible, maybe use red light and try and detect animals using their lights in their environment, so we can understand more. Are we right? Are these theories right? Have we guessed correctly in terms of how these lights are used? And I think we're going to see a lot more of those stories coming out, or proving probably to be true, but learning more about what those bioluminescence abilities are actually for with these amazing new ways of seeing into the deep. And I can't wait to find out more. It's going to be super cool. I mean, everything glows. Corals glow. I mean, sea cucumbers glow, fish glow, shrimp glow. Everything is somehow shining a light at something else, whether it's to say, hey, come here, whether it's to say, leave me alone. All sorts of possibilities are out there.
You also tell a story of how it is that creatures are able to perceive light, the vision of these animals. And apparently this has to do with, seeing a broad range of color potentially.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the things I think maybe it was a clue to perhaps to the fact that there's a lot of light making going on in the deep ocean. When we find, you know, we have found for a long time animals living in the deep that have functioning eyes. They have, you know, really good eyes. In contrast that to animals we'd find on land in very dark places like in caves, and often there'll be fish and other animals that have either lost the ability to see or they've actually lost their eyes entirely. You get blind fish and all sorts of things. And, you know, an eyesight is it's something that requires a lot of energy. So if you can't see anything, then, you know, often it happens that evolution takes you down a pathway to, you know, leads down a pathway towards losing that organ because it's kind of useless. But that hasn't happened in the deep ocean. And so that is a kind of a clue to say, well, maybe there is something to see down there. And, you know, and that definitely is the case. And we found, you know, scientists have found all sorts of organisms, animals living through the deep ocean with the most exquisite vision. It really blowing anything terrestrial, I would say, out of the water. We've got fish that have dozens of different types of rod pigments in their eyes. These little things called spiny silver fins that live down in the twilight zone. And these rod pigments, we have them, and it's for dim light vision, but we only have one type. So that's why at night, or when the light is low, humans have pretty much monochromatic vision. We can't really make out colors in the dim light. But these guys have a whole bunch of different types of these rods, which they can then use to compare different wavelengths. And studies have shown that they actually are focusing in, if you like, on the blues and greens of the wavelengths of the rainbow. And that's because that's the most common color that bioluminescent light is produced in. So they are like tuning in their vision to the lights that are generally going off around them, these animal-made fireworks down in the deep ocean. And so they can make out really distinctly figure out just very slightly different colors of blues and greens down there. Whereas we might just see a sort of white flash. We wouldn't be able to make it out in that intensity in any kind of color. There also, I should mention these amazing amphipods, these cousins of shrimp, which live in the open sea down in the deep ocean. And they have 32 retinas. Now, we have two, one in each eye, and that's it. These guys have 32 in each eye connected by fiber optic cables. And we think they do that to be able to detect these very dim flashes of bioluminescent light. And they do, it's like a whole reinvention of how to see. These eyes are absolutely extraordinary and really showing how the physical conditions of the deep sea can really lead to these amazing adaptations for survival and for thriving when there's only some very dim lights, but it's, useful to be able to see it if you can.
I would like for you maybe to contextualize all of this life that's happening down there within the broader, ecosystem. And this has to do with deep below the water, you've got some pretty hot earth. And there's a story here to be told about how creatures are metabolizing and getting their energy, and they do it sans photosynthesis. I mean, there's a chemosynthesis, I understand, that takes the place of photosynthesis, and there's kind of a chemical story of how animals are doing this.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this for me is one of the stories that we've learned about life from the deep ocean, which really has, when we first discovered this, when it was first discovered about 40 years ago, it blew the minds of biologists because up until that point, it was assumed that life on Earth, and as far as we know, life in the universe so far, depends on that sunlight. It's the energy coming from the sun that's powering photosynthesis in plants and seaweeds and things. And that's the basis of all the food chain. So that's where all the energy was coming for a biological life, as far as we knew. And then deep sea geologists actually were the first to dive down in submersibles down to very great depths in the Pacific Ocean to investigate these geological features which they had discovered called hydrothermal vents. And this is where basically hot springs forming very far down at the cracks of tectonic plates down in the ocean. We've got scorching hot water pouring out of them, much hotter than springs on land because all the pressure of the water means it doesn't boil. So we're talking hundreds of degrees. Toxic fluids pouring out of the seabed, incredibly high pressure, very hot, not the sort of place you would imagine life at all to thrive. And yet there they were, and they looked out the window and couldn't believe their eyes. I mean, these were geologists who, weren't there for life. They were there for rocks, but they saw just the most extraordinary ecosystems, giant tube worms, 6 feet long, clams the size of dinner plates. And this was just the beginning. I mean, since then, people have been exploring hydrothermal vents all through the oceans and finding everyone has a new and strange creatures living on them. Yeti crabs with hairy arms, sock creatures, purple sock creatures, we call them, which do look like a purple tube sock that's been thrown onto the seabed. All sorts of, snails with metal shells, just weird, weird things living on these vents. And, besides all of that, which is wonderful, what that discovery led to was this new insight into a different way for life to exist on Earth. And that is this thing called chemosynthesis. I call it the dark alternative to photosynthesis. I mean, it is a similar sort of process involving basically taking carbon dioxide and converting that into sugars to the basis of food for the rest of the food chain. Only instead of using energy from the sun, these ecosystems are based on microbes that can do this with chemical energy. They're taking chemicals that are gushing up in these hydrothermal vents through the seabed, mostly methane and hydrogen sulfide, and using that as a source of energy. The chemical bonds basically within those chemicals are used to fix carbon dioxide and make sugars. And these microbes live all over these vents. Some things eat them. There are a lot of these animals that have those microbes, bacteria actually living inside them. There's a lot of symbiosis going on with these microbes basically just happily living inside a tube worm or in the fur of a Yeti crab. That's keeping them in the right place they need to be, nice and close to these vents, not too close so they get scorched, but a nice supply of chemicals. And in return, those animals feed off those microbes. So it's a chemical source of energy that we just didn't know about. And I think for me, one of the just really exciting reasons that, you know, it kind of just opens up possibilities of what life could be, maybe on other planets as well. Here we are thinking it has to be a planet with a sun, you know, with a source of energy. That's what life is about. And here is a whole ecosystem we've discovered, a whole string of ecosystems that live in the dark, completely disconnected from sunlight. So maybe there's more out in the, you know, elsewhere in the universe. By the way, there are hydrothermal vents, we know, on different planets and different moons. Saturn's moon Enceladus, Jupiter's moon Europa, we think those have hydrothermal vents. So who knows what's going on there, but maybe something quite exciting.
Well, the darkness that we've talked about so far has to do with the absence of sunlight, but there's a different kind of darkness. Darkness is a metaphor for the perils that are faced by these creatures and life down in the depths. I'm talking about plastic waste, raw sewage, oil spills, radioactivity, even deep sea mining. You address this, and it's a sad story. And I did not even know that there was trawling that happens deep, deep in the sea. I had assumed trawling for fish was something that was kind of closer to the surface. But these interventions, what do you make of it all?
Yeah, it's a sad story, isn't it? I guess we might just assume that the deep ocean is so big and so remote that it's, you know, out of reach of human impacts, or that we wouldn't bother going there. I mean, in terms of the pollution, I guess it's not really a surprise that plastic ends up in the deep ocean, because plastic is everywhere now. And that's the really depressing truth that we're uncovering, is it's, you know, it's in the air, it's in Arctic ice, it's at the bottom of the deepest ocean trench, you know, it's down there in the Mariana Trench. So plastic is everywhere. But yeah, the kind of the active intervention in the deep, the active exploitation of the deep is shocking. You know, there seems to be very little good reason for exploiting the deep ocean. We're talking certainly with fishing, a lot of the animals that would be targeted and are being targeted by some deep sea trawling are just the kind of things that really aren't suited well for anything, any kind of sustainable exploitation. These animals can live for an incredibly long time. One of the key species I write about is this thing called the orange ruffy. And they, we now know, can live for 250 years. These are not especially surprising looking fish. They sort of sit on a plate. There they are. But they, you know, live for centuries, probably don't mature until they're in their 40s. And they can be scooped up in their millions from underwater mountains where they congregate when they do eventually get around to spawning. And their numbers can be very quickly depleted with very little recovery in the subsequent decades. We've seen very, very little recovery of these animals in places where they've been heavily hunted through the Pacific and other parts of the world. So really, you know, there's not a good reason for going into the deep ocean. My take on it is that if we can sort ourselves out in the shallow seas, And we know how. We have the science. We know what we would need to do to sustainably fish the surface seas and to provide food for an awful lot of people. If we can figure that out and do that, get the politics in there, get the economics in there, we would have no need to go into the deep ocean and to make changes to a place we're still learning about, and leave alone those species that really aren't suited at all well to this kind of exploitation. You know, it's not looking good for any of these, whether that we're talking about even mid-water animals. There's talk about fishing the twilight zone as well, for these tiny fish that swim through the twilight zone. Even that comes with risks we don't fully understand that could affect the climate. They're pulling carbon down into the deep. We don't want to touch that. Let's leave that alone. And yeah, let's figure out the fisheries we already have up in the surface seas. And I think we can do that. And it would mean we could just leave the deep alone.
It seems to me, and you can help me with this, it seems to me that our lack of restraint in what we have done to exploit the oceans comes just hand in glove with a lack of regulation. I don't know if it's a chicken and an egg story, but we're not restrained if we're not regulating it. And under cloak of darkness, a lot of things can happen that nobody will ever know about. And the deeper you go, it seems that people can behave with near impunity. Am I so wrong?
No, I mean, you are. You're right, exactly. I think, I mean, the oceans in general suffer from this life, you know, this eternal problem of being out of sight and out of mind. And the deep ocean is just the ultimate place where we can't see, without these amazing technologies. And even then, it's hard to really, gather what the impacts of all of this will be and understand that. So, yeah, I mean, it is, it's a huge part of our planet. It's very hard to go there and see it and understand the impacts and see the impacts. We're never going to stand back and look at it like we can, those terrible scenes from aerial footage or satellite imagery of, say, forests being cut down. We can look at how much we've lost of the Amazon rainforest. We aren't really ever going to get the equivalent in the deep ocean. It is so hidden. And yet the same levels of destruction, if not more, I would argue, could take place, especially if we're talking about things like deep sea mining. These mines could open up over just unthinkably huge swathes of the deep ocean to exploit metals down there, which some people want to get their hands on. And I don't think we're ever going to have that visual picture of the impact that's going to have. All we have and what we have to rely on and what we need to give time to and resources to is for the scientists to be able to say why these, learn about why these ecosystems and these places are so important for the health of the planet and what might happen if they are disturbed. And I can only hope that, this lack of regulation can be changed and that we can make a different decision about how we use the deep ocean compared to perhaps the rest of the planet and decide that it's this place that is too special, too different, potentially just too important for the health of the planet, from climate regulation to nutrient cycling to carbon sequestration, all sorts of things like that. Those things are far too important to mess with. Just besides the fact that the deep is so important for biology and for life on Earth. And, why not keep it that way? Why not just keep this wondrous place full of all these extraordinary creatures? One of the parts of the planet that we don't interfere with, that we don't exploit for our own gains. It's not why it's there. We can give its own right to exist just anyway, just by anything we might gain from it. So I think that the deep is, it's a very sad story, but I think we do have the possibility of making really strong decisions to change our ways as humanity and make a better choice for the planet. It's definitely still not too late.
Her book is titled The Brilliant Abyss, Exploring the Majestic Hidden Life of the Deep Ocean and the Looming Threat that Imperils It. Helen Scales, thanks for being with us.
It's been such a pleasure. Thank you so much.
The deepest parts of the ocean, they may be fascinating, but very difficult to access for us humans. All kinds of physics and technical problems. Our brains and our bodies don't like it down there. So we have been getting robots to do some of that work for us, and now maybe even cyborgs. Mechanizing jellyfish for deep ocean exploration, is that possible? Might become a thing. We're going to consider that when we come back to Constant Wonder. Stay with us. You're listening to Constant Wonder. I'm Marcus Smith. If you want to explore the deepest depths of the sea, you're going to need something more than just scuba gear. Even a military submarine is not up to the task. What you generally need is robots, or maybe one day cyborgs, animal-machine hybrids. Are we going to figure out how to do that? Maybe with, say, a jellyfish to do the exploration for us? Well, here's part of a conversation I had with Nicole Hsu, who is a PhD candidate in bioengineering at Stanford University, who is on the task.
And you can kind of think of the jellyfish as like a circular piece of jello, right? Anything you stick into it is going to fall out immediately. So we looked at different types of glues. There's a surgical glue called histocryl flexible, which is used in prenatal surgeries. And I think that's really great for that purpose, but you really need to dry out the surface a lot before the glue can really stick. So it didn't work for our purposes for sticking anything to the animals. And we also tried this muscle-based adhesive, muscle as in like the type of muscles that are sea creatures, the type that we eat, not like going to the gym and getting swole muscles. But that also really didn't work very well just because you had to clear off the surface. And so instead, we decided to stick the electronics directly into the animal tissue by using a wooden pin. And this is actually really nice because the wooden pin has microscopic barbs that hook into the tissue very well. And I'm glad that you reiterated this in the beginning, but the jellyfish don't have a brain, they don't have pain receptors, they're not stressed out in any way. And if they were stressed out, they would be secreting a lot of mucus, and we don't see any evidence of that. So we're not hurting the animals by doing this.
How big is the device? Is it the size of, a little small battery for a camera or something?
Kind of. It's about 2 centimeters in diameter. So you can think of it as the shape of a coin or the size of a coin. And the animals that we use vary between 10 centimeters to 20 centimeters, possibly like a dinner plate.
Yeah, and I want to get into the reason somebody would be doing this in the first place, but hold off on that for just a little bit. I'm still
Okay.
just interested in the you attach it. You said a wooden pin with that has little probably microscopic barbs for adhesion.
So we actually just, I'm going to let you in on a secret. We just use a toothpick, and it feels very smooth to us, but it has these microscopic barbs in it if you look at it under a microscope.
And so you attach the device to the toothpick to the jellyfish.
Exactly. We have all of our electronics in this waterproof housing, and then we stick a toothpick to that and embed that device in the center of the animal. And then we have electrodes going out that embed into the sides of the animal where the muscle is. So we're kind of controlling it the way a cardiac pacemaker would control a heart.
And is this device going to go out into the ocean on this jellyfish or in this jellyfish and be retrieved later? Or is this all about just uploading the information to some satellite somewhere?
Oh, absolutely. We would want to retrieve the device. We've thought very carefully about this, and at the moment, our design iteration isn't at the point where we're actually deploying these robots out into the ocean to collect things for us without monitoring them very closely. But we just want to be very wary that we're not creating e-waste or any plastic waste in the ocean. So, I think
So
it's really important.
that's the reason for retrieval is not to pollute.
Yes, exactly. And we do want to incorporate more biodegradable electronics and biocompatible plastics in the future as well.
Yeah, I mean the idea, I don't know, do whales and sharks and dolphins eat jellyfish?
I think that's an open question right now. Lots of scientists are trying to figure out what actually eats the jellyfish just because there are so many jellyfish in the ocean and there are only increasing numbers given changes in the climate over time. So yeah, that's still an open
There's a
question
spike
there.
in jellyfish population?
Oh yes. So there is with climate change and increasing temperatures and pHs, jellyfish seem to be doing particularly well with all these changes. So
Yeah.
that
Now,
is a consideration.
have you been able to ascertain that by implanting this device, it doesn't in any way compromise whatever functions a jellyfish has, its swimming, its behavior, all of that sort of stuff?
The jellyfish seem to be doing fine with the device embedded. There's an open question of whether the animals can still feed. And so we haven't conducted these tests overnight using our entire self-contained system. So that is still an open question, but there's no reason really that the animals would be doing worse with our device over time. And we are very conscious to let the animals rest as well. So in the future, we could have the animals swimming to a certain location and then turn it off so the animal can do its own thing and collect its data naturally where it would want to go. And then we could turn it back on to retrieve it later on.
Now, I promise, we're going to get to the reasons behind any of this. But I
Yeah.
still am so, I'm so interested in the idea. Do you have to go out and find them and implant them, or can you farm them somehow and raise them in tanks?
That's a really good question. So all of our experiments so far have been done with lab animals. So we get animals from Cabrillo Marine Aquarium, and they're very generous enough to donate them to us. And then we implant the devices in them and conduct all the experiments in the lab. So these are lab grade species. But the nice thing about this particular species of moon jellyfish is that they're found in a variety of different locations. So we could go down to very deep depths or very salty waters or not so salty waters and collect the animals, implant them, and then send those out into their own natural environment. So we're also not introducing more jellyfish to a certain area.
Now, this is not like the experimentations that happen during wartime where somebody's trying to gather intelligence for their purposes on land or, you know, trying to find U-boats
No.
or anything. This is about scientific exploration and learning. And why would this mode of transportation for a device, why would this be preferable to strapping it on some other animal?
That's a really good question. So when we think about different bio-inspired aquatic vehicles, you can either create something that mimics how a fish swims or a stingray, for example, and those have a lot of different advantages as well. So fish are very maneuverable and very fast. Manta rays have incredible turning capabilities. And jellyfish are really nice, not only because they're found in this huge variety of environments, but because they're very energy efficient. So I don't know if you want to get into this metric of energy efficiency called cost of transport, but you can kind of think of it as like the opposite of miles per gallon. So a low cost of transport is really good. Jellyfish have the lowest cost of transport of all the animals. And so we can really use them as a way to create more low power robots that we can send out into the ocean. And you're absolutely right. The main advantage of our system and what we really want to do is use this robot in conjunction with a lot of existing technologies just to expand the performance portfolio of what we can actually monitor in the ocean.
Now, just a moment ago, we were talking about sending out albatrosses with devices on them, and they have an incredible range. Mm-hmm. I know nothing about the range of a jellyfish, and I'm hoping you do.
Mm-hmm.
Do you?
Well, it depends. What do you mean by range? Like there's
yeah. Can you put one of these, you know, Stanfords there on, you know, near the Pacific West Coast, and you put it on a jellyfish? Is it going to end up near Korea?
That's a good question. I don't think people have tracked where individual jellyfish go, but I think that's an open question. They do migrate lots of different places, and they are primarily carried by currents in the ocean. So if we deployed these biohybrid robots out into certain areas where we know that the currents are going to carry them in different places, we could really expand where we can monitor the ocean. So there are a lot of really good ways of monitoring the ocean right now. There are different types of underwater vehicles that are really fast and maneuverable, but those can still require a lot of energy. And so we see a biohybrid jellyfish robot as advantageous because we want to measure things like pH and temperature and salinity in different areas of the ocean that these existing technologies can't necessarily reach. But in addition to that, we could put cameras on these animals and just go around and see what is the natural animal behavior. So are there new species of underwater creatures out there? And we know that there most likely are, but, you know, what are the ways that we can expand how we monitor what's going on in the ocean, whether that's taking samples of the water for us and tracking changes in the climate. So are temperatures actually increasing over time in certain areas? Or if the water is becoming saltier or more acidic, what's going on with different things in the ecosystem? So I think this is another tool that can be really used to monitor all these processes.
Nicole Hsu trained in bioengineering at Stanford University. Constant Wonder. Our show is a production of BYU Radio.